I'm a scientist, and when science, one of the things we learn is we need precisely defined terms and the right names. Indeed, sometimes confusion can happen in science because you use a word which doesn't have a precise enough meaning. So I think it's important for us to have objective terms. That is, terms, and I'll define that later as we go through the talk. So anyway, we need to use the right words and the right concepts. So I'm going to talk to you about naming and the right definition of words. Now then, there are two ways to know Islam. One is the subjective way, when you ask for someone's opinion. What I want to deal with are objective facts. Facts that if I tell you something, you can go look it up for yourself. So I don't deal with opinions, I use fact-based thought. I also use logic, classical logic, whereas most people in dealing subjective, if they don't agree with your argument, they just say, oh, you're evil, you're a bigot, you're a hater. And I come from the knowledge of the Quran, the Sirah, the Hadith, and will define these words for you. But everything I say you can look up. And I also teach the history of jihad and the history of the dhimmi, and we'll define the word dhimmi later in the talk. But the opposition, and people who oppose what I say that it doesn't exist. I'm for free speech, and those who oppose me say that I'm a hate speaker, and yet all I do is to quote Muhammad and to quote Allah. I deal only with politics. I do not deal with religion, and perhaps this is the most important concept I'll bring to you today. I have no opinions about religion one way or the other. I hope you have one and it works for you. That's all I care about. We'll discover as we go through this language that there is a language of separation, and the reason is Islam is its own complete civilization. We like to think that everyone is a member of our civilization and we can accommodate them with multiculturalism. This concept is foreign to Islam. Islam has its own language and its own meaning of terms, and what I teach are the meaning of Islamic terms. Everything I'm going to tell you, we can look up in the classical works. Part of the reason for this talk is I meet very interesting people. That's the best thing about what I do, actually. And I was approached by a high-level law enforcement officer at the federal level, and he said, we have a lot of trouble in doing our work because we've now been issued orders from the president that there are words that cannot be used. For instance, jihad. In America, the law enforcement never uses that word. Instead, it's some form of terrorism. As you all know, in September 11, 2001, Al-Qaeda attacked America at the World Trade Center, and there was a commission report on that, the 9/11 Commission. In the original commission report, there were 714 mentions that dealt with Islam and Muslims and jihad. 714. Today, nothing that comes out of the federal government or state government ever mentions the word jihad. So this is a problem. If we're not using the right words, how do we have the right thoughts? And that's what this law enforcement director said. He said, we cannot have meaningful discussions because these words that we're using don't really have a precise meaning. These are subjective names. Terrorism. Why is terrorism a subjective word? Well, it doesn't really occur in the doctrine. Violent extremism was something that Obama brought to the table, and combating Islam was transformed into combating violent extremism. Well, there is violence in the Sirah, but and nowhere in the Islamic works do they ever refer to themselves as violent extremists. Then another popular one in America is moderate Islam and radical Islam. You can read all the Quran you want and you'll never find those words. And then we have moderate and radical Muslims. One of the things we'll learn to do today is to distinguish between a Muslim and Islam. Now that may seem simple, but I find in the media there's an absolute confusion about this. Everything I'm going to teach you about the words to use comes from Islamic doctrine. Here's the beauty of this. Everyone can get the same result I got. Just look it up. All right. The term submission is used for Islam, and who do we submit to? We submit to Allah. Where do we find Allah? We find it in the Quran. Now, here's something interesting about the Quran. When you read it and you have knowledge of Islam, there is not enough to practice Islam found in the Quran. It's simply not there. It says to pray, but how to pray? It says to donate to charity, but how do you do that? So the things that every Muslim does, the five pillars, are not found in the Quran. What's important is that the Quran tells us in 91 different verses that every Muslim, and it even goes further and says that every human being, is to live their life exactly like Muhammad did. 91 verses. So this is not just a verse or two. The entire Quran basically points to Muhammad and says, be like him. Where do we find Muhammad? Well, we find a lot about Muhammad in his biography called the Sirah. It's 800 pages of fine print. And we know more about Muhammad's personal private life than I know about George Washington's private life. We know incredible details, his bathroom habits, his sexual habits, how he spoke, what kind of camels he liked. We know a lot about him. Then we have the hadith, which are little traditions. So let's go through and define some of these. First definition, Islam is the doctrine found in the Quran, the Sirah, and the hadith, the three books. If any idea is in these three books, it is Islam. If it's not in those three books, it is not Islam. And that is my criticism of the naming done in the media, because it's not found in the Islamic doctrine. Here they are. These are actually the ones that I use for my research. We have the hadith, which I printed out on hard copy, because you need all these in electronic format. Here's the sirah, which, as you can tell, has been greatly abused by me studying it, but that's my personal copy. And then we have the Quran. What do you notice about these three books laying here? The smallest one is the Quran. Let's measure that. But before we measure it, let's take a look at how Islam is constructed. We have the Quran, the Sirah, and the Hadith, which I call the trilogy, which is three books, is all that means. But the Sunnah of Muhammad is found in the Sirah and the Hadith. So this is the intellectual structure of Islamic knowledge. Another thing, I do not discuss Muslims, I discuss Islam. In my opinion, only former Muslims or Muslims can discuss Muslims and what it means to be inside of Islam. I only discuss Islam and what's on the outside. Let me say this again. I discuss ideas. I don't discuss people. And I recommend this to you. When I say something, I can look it up. If I say something about a Muslim, whether I like him or don't like him, that's subjective. So I don't deal with that. And here we have the size. We can see here that the Quran is only 14%. The biography is about a quarter. And over half is the Hadith. Islam is 14% Allah and 86% Muhammad, or as I like to say, it's this much Allah and this much Muhammad. Now, this is good news, because everyone's heard of somebody who tried to read the Quran and was like, oh, it's too confusing. Who here would maintain that they could not understand the biography of a man? You're born, you go through life, you die. Every biography consists of that. So if the majority of Islam is to study Muhammad, then we're on easy ground. Read the biography, and then read the little anecdotes, the little spot pictures of his life. Do not try to read the Quran first, is my advice to people. Instead, read Muhammad. Once you know Muhammad, the Quran is easy. It becomes like, oh, very obvious why that needed to happen. I speak in the terms of the voice of Allah and the voice of Muhammad. People say to me, well, Bill, you never went to school to study the doctrine of Islam. I say, I have two professors. Their names are Allah and Muhammad. And I speak with their tongue. You'll see that all I talk about are the things that Allah and Muhammad taught me, and I want them to teach you. Do not trust the media. Do not trust experts. There are only two experts. And if anyone says something about Islam that disagrees with Islam, with the doctrine, I don't care if it's an imam, a professor at Al-Azhar University, doesn't matter. Only what Muhammad said and Allah said makes any difference. So, we don't need all the experts. All we need is Muhammad and Allah. I'm fond of fact-based reasoning. I'm a scientist. Everything that I say about Islam, I can point to Muhammad or point to Allah. And I want to teach you to do the same. There's a concept in mathematics called completeness. That is, if you left anything out. When we put the trilogy, Quran, Sirah, Hadith, we can wrap our arms around it. Everything inside here is Islam. Everything outside of this is not Islam. So if somebody says Islam is the religion of peace, you don't really find that inside of these three books. So therefore, it is wrong. We need objective thought, objective naming. Let's start with our first one. Radical, extreme, and moderate Islam. Everyone's heard these terms. Now then, if we're going to discuss Islam, we need to immediately take a look at the Quran, because there are two Qurans and two Muhammads. and we'll dwell a lot on this, because there's much confusion about this. But radical is not a word found in the Quran, the Sirah, the Hadith. So I say, it's not applicable. I don't use that term. And there are two Muhammads, and we'll see what those two Muhammads are. Before we can discuss any further, we have to talk about a concept of dualism, which is a concept that I discovered. I would say that this is perhaps my biggest discovery, was to use statistical analysis and to show why Islam is so confusing. Because we see this all the time in the media. The media will report on a jihadi running a truck down some people, but everybody responds and says, oh, I know this Muslim, he's a kind, gentle person. So which is real, the jihadi or the nice Muslim? And we'll discover that the answer is yes. Now here we go to the Quran. There are two Qurans in one binding. And those two Qurans are the early Quran and the latter Quran. This is the beginning of dualism, because these two books do not align at all. The two Qurans, the early and the latter, or Meccan Quran and Medinan Quran, are so different that I could take a class of high school students and with a one-hour lecture and give them a what in America we call a cheat sheet, that is the rules written down on one piece of paper, and a stranger could come into the room, talk to these students and say, here's a verse, read you the verse. And the students would be able to look at their sheet and go, oh, that's from Mecca. Oh, the next verse, that's from Medina. That's how different they are. Here's an example. You have your religion and I have mine. That comes from Mecca. Now that sounds very tolerant. As a matter of fact, if that were the only thing in the Quran, I wouldn't be here. But there's another Quran. I shall cast terror into the hearts of the kafirs. Kafir are unbelievers. That's the word I use because that's the original Arabic. It is precise and correct. That is the proper term, and I use it. I shall cast terror into the hearts of the kafirs, strike off their heads, strike off the very tips of their fingers. Now, my hobby is woodworking, and I use very sharp power tools. And one of the things you learn when you're doing woodworking is you don't want your fingers in the way of those sharp tools. You don't want the tips of your fingers cut off. I've met men who've done this. So when the Quran says that the kafirs can have their fingers cut off, I'm like, ooh, I don't like that. Because I've seen what happens to people when that happens. Let's talk about the two Muhammads. This is the growth curve of Islam. For some reason or another, no one has ever produced this curve before, and this curve comes from the Sirah, the biography of Muhammad. Once you have this idea, it's very easy. Here's a summary of Muhammad's life. He preached the religion of Islam for 13 years in Mecca, converted 150 Arabs to be Muslim. That's about 10 a year. That's not a growing business. But he was driven out of Mecca. He moved to Medina, where he had some partisan followers. That is, there were already Muslims in Medina. And he became a jihadist and a politician. I'm not making this up. It's exceedingly clearly written. So we have two different Muhammads, because there is no jihad in Muhammad's life in Mecca. But there is enormous jihad in Medina. Muhammad, in the last 9 years of his life, was involved in 95 events of jihad. That's about one every month. That's about one a month. So what we see here is jihad is systemic. It is part of the doctrine. It's not a verse or two. In America, people like to say, well, there's a verse or two. No. All right. As you can tell, I'm a scientist, I love graphs. Now what do we have here? I've plotted the amount devoted to jihad. In Mecca, there is no jihad. In Medina, 24% of the Quran in Medina is about jihad. Systemic doctrine, not a verse. The Sirah, the biography of Muhammad, 2/3 of his biography deals with jihad. Think about that. In the Hadith, 21%. So the trilogy with three books is nearly a third, 31%, devoted to jihad. It's not a small part. Now let's go back here to Muhammad's career. At the end of Medina, when he died, every Arab within his political horizon was a Muslim. So, since that's what made him a success, why would Muslims abandon this? Do you understand my point here? Now then, when you read the Quran, you're struck with the amount of Jewish material in it. Indeed, the Meccan Quran, the early Quran, has an enormous amount of Jewish material. The story of Moses is told 38 times. There's very little Jew hatred within the early Meccan Quran, and that only comes in the last year. But in Medina, the Quran devotes 17% of its text to Jew hatred. So, we ask the question, is Islam favorable to the Jews? The answer is yes. Is Islam condemning of the Jews? The answer is yes. 12% of the Sirah is devoted to Jew hatred, 8.9% of the Hadith. The total trilogy is over 9% devoted to Jew hatred. And yet part of it absolutely praises the Jews. Now, the gold standard in America for Jew hatred is Mein Kampf. I read Mein Kampf, and 7% of the paragraphs in Mein Kampf deal with Jew hatred, whereas 9% deal with the trilogy. Let's look at this dualism, which is what I call it. We have anti-Jew text, yes and no. We have jihad, yes and no, because there's 24% of it in Medina, none in Mecca. The growth of Islam, we see that there are two different Muhammads, a peaceful religious Muhammad and a jihadist Muhammad. And here we have just the reminder that there's different verses in the Quran. Now, people spend an enormous amount of time trying to resolve the question, which is it? Is Islam peaceful or is Islam warlike? Because in our mind, these two things contrast, and you can't be both. But in science, we do have such things. The electron can be matter or it can be energy. So you ask the question, is the electron pure energy or pure matter? And the answer is yes. They're both. This cannot be divided. We can't say, well, let's talk about it, because I think it would be better if the electron were matter, not energy. Then you can show all the evidence for it being having a material basis, but then the person would say, look, there's just as many experiments which show it's pure energy. It cannot be resolved, and in science, particularly quantum mechanics, we embrace this as the dual nature of reality. The same thing has to be done with Islam. We must embrace both of them. This turns out to be Islam's greatest strength, because it's chameleon-like. Why, this man who's an imam is the most peaceful, gentle man I've ever met. So therefore, Islam must be peaceful and gentle. And the answer is yes. But look at Islamic State. It's such a terror, a horror show. That can't be the real Islam. And the answer is yes, it is. So this confusion keeps people off balance. They want to believe one and not the other. So they want to say, well, the peaceful Muslim is the real Muslim. The moderate Muslim is the real Muslim. And he is a real Muslim. But so is Islamic State jihadist. Now, we're going to deal with the word kafir here. I've studied religious text all of my life. When I was 16 years old, I taught the adult Bible class at my church. My first job was to be a minister. So I've been studying religion all of my life. I've studied Buddhism in depth. I've studied Hinduism in depth. My first study of Islam came when I was 30 years old, and I studied Sufism, mystical Islam. But when you read all the texts of Buddhism, Christianity, Judaism, and Hinduism, you're struck with how much of their doctrine is about how to be a Christian, how to be a Hindu, how to be a Buddhist, how to be a Jew. But most of the trilogy, those three books, is about me. This is very odd. Now then, Christians, there is a term for religious terms inside of Islam for Christians, Jews, pagans, polytheists. Those are all religious terms. But the Christian can be treated just like the Jew, just like the Hindu, just like the Buddhist, just like the atheist. So we need a common political word, and the text gives us this word. That word is kafir, K-I-F-R, or K-A-F-I-R. That's what the Quran calls me. When you read a book of tradition, of say, by a manual on Sharia, and it says the unbeliever, in the Arabic, it doesn't say unbeliever. It says kafir. The reason I use that word is unbeliever is a neutral kind of term. But kafir, every verse, every paragraph, every hadith about the kafir is evil and harmful. So therefore, I don't say unbeliever, I say kafir. I don't say non-Muslim, I say kafir. Why? That's what the text tells me to do. So I recommend the popularization of the word kafir. By the way, Muslims do not like you to use this word. I was debating a Muslim and I said, the first thing we establish is I'm a kafir. I think the Quran is a derivative text and Muhammad was confused. The Muslim said, why would you call yourself that? That's the worst word. I says, that's your word for me. Except you say kafir hajis, which is filthy kafir. Those are your dirty words, and I know your dirty words, and I will use those dirty words because it's the same word Muhammad used, it's the same word Allah uses. I am a kafir. And here we go again with my charts. Nearly two-thirds, 64% of the Quran is devoted to the kafir. Do you see why if you've studied religion all of your life, you've studied a Buddhist text, and then you read this, you say, this is not about how to be a Muslim. It's how bad the kafirs are. 81% of the Sirah deals with Muhammad's fight with a kafir. 37% of the Hadith, over half of the trilogy is about me and you. That's a whole different perspective. Now I'm going to give you a definition. Political Islam and religious Islam. The part of Islam that deals with salvation, going to heaven, avoiding hell, is religious. I don't discuss this. I have no interest in this. I wish everyone best, including a Muslim, but I don't care about Islamic salvation. The part of Islam that deals with the kafir is political. Why is it political? Look, I'm not involved in the religion at all. I just told you I'm not afraid of their hell or interested in their paradise. So therefore, it is a political action. On 9/11, when the World Trade Towers were destroyed, that was a political action. Using guided missiles, whether they're computer-guided or human-guided, is a political act. But it had a religious motivation, because those who die committing this political act immediately go to heaven. So we need to separate out politics from religion. When the Muslims command the street for Friday prayer and take over the streets, that is a political act. If we went out and blockaded the street here, we would meet some men with blue lights on their car who would tell us, get out of the street or we will arrest you. The law says you cannot blockade the common road. That's a political action. The prayer is religious, but it has a political component. Follow? We need to separate these two. I do not object to Muslims praying on Friday, but I do object to them commandeering the common roads to do so. That's politics, and I object to it. The kafir is totally outside of the religion, and the majority of Islamic doctrine is about politics. This is something we can talk about. I don't want to discuss the religion at all, have no interest in it, but I will discuss the politics to my dying day. The beauty of this is, in America, we have the First Amendment, which guarantees religious freedom. You can practice any religion you want. But it also gives us the right, with freedom of speech, to discuss politics till we die of exhaustion. So we need to discuss the politics of Islam, political Islam, and just leave religious Islam behind. And remember, the majority of the doctrine is political. Now then, let's go back to moderate, extreme, and radical. Islam is peaceful and religious. Islam is jihad and political. Both of these statements are correct. In America, we want to say, well, which one's real? The answer is yes. This is a different way of thinking. Dualism is inherent within Islam, and we must embrace this dualism and use this dualism. Islam is Islam. Erdogan of Turkey has only said one thing that I agree with. He says there is no radical Islam. There is no moderate Islam. Islam is Islam. And I go, Erdogan, you're right. Maybe for the first time, but you're right. So, Islam is dualistic. It always has two views, and I think we should embrace both of those. When we talk about Islam, we should mention both. Both sides are equally true. One's not better than the other, one's not worse than the other. So let's just do it. Now let's deal with the concept of a good Muslim, a nice Muslim. This is a popular concept in America. The measure of a Muslim is Islam. That sounds simple, but people have a lot of trouble understanding that. It is not up to me to say that a Muslim is good or bad. The Quran, the Sirah, and the Hadith will tell us whether a Muslim is good or bad. And how does it say about a good Muslim? They follow the Sunnah, they follow the Quran. So if they're following the Sunnah and the Quran, then they are good Muslims. That's the reason Islamic State is all those people, the jihadis, cutting off people's heads. Those are good Muslims. How can that be? Because Muhammad repeatedly had men executed by cutting off their head. If you're supposed to follow the perfect example of Muhammad, killing a kafir by cutting off his head is pure Islam. Pure political Islam. Let's embrace that. So, a good Muslim, or what we call a nice Muslim, let's use that term, is a Meccan Muslim. That is the proper word. You follow the five pillars, you don't practice jihad, you're a Meccan Muslim. You follow the Quran of Mecca. Osama bin Laden was a good Muslim. The head of Islamic State is a good Muslim. Cruel, perhaps, but good. Moderate Muslim. Again, we want to discuss what moderate Islam means. We don't want to discuss Muslims. This is very hard for people to understand. Muslims cannot change Islam. You cannot reform something because Muslims can get together and vote on something, and it has no meaning to Islam. It's just another vote. There's no authority to appeal to in Islam except Muhammad and Allah. Muslims don't create it. Therefore, to create a moderate Muslim, you need a moderate Islam. But we just covered the fact there's no such thing as a moderate Islam or a radical Islam. There's only Islam. This is hard for people to understand because they want to think that the good Muslims can all get together and create a good Islam. All the Muslims in the world, 1.6 billion, the number seems to be lately, if all 1.6 billion Muslims said, jihad is wrong, we will not practice it, they would not change a single letter of Islam. Muhammad's example is eternal. The Quran is eternal, perfect, universal. Perfect. How do you change something that's perfect? How do you reform something that's perfect? Muhammad's life was perfect. So if you're going to reform Islam, that means you have to take something out of Muhammad and out of the Quran. You can't do that. It doesn't work. It's like saying, well, on the numbering system, we'll take away all the even numbers. You can't do that. So the moderate practices the Meccan Islam. He practices the five pillars. But he's not the best of Muslims at all. A moderate Muslim is a nice Muslim, so they don't practice Medina. Now then, let's talk about the extremist, who is not extreme, the jihadist. He is a Medinan Muslim because he practices the Quran of Medina and the Hadith of Medina. So these are the proper words, Meccan Muslim and Medinan Muslims. Now these words are not commonly known, but I have no objection to using words which create a question. So I think we should use these terms. The person says, what do you mean Meccan Muslims? Well, let me tell you about the life of Muhammad. He's a Medinan Muslim. What do you mean, sir? Well, let me tell you about Muhammad's life. Those are precise terms that come from Islam. I didn't make them up. Now then, let's talk about migration, because the proper term is hijra, and that's the term we should use. Hijra is so important, it's the knee of the curve. Hijra is what started the real growth of Islam. After Muhammad migrated to Medina, Medina was half Jewish. 2 years later, all the Jews were dead. The German word, Judenrein. But it brought him success. What brought him the jihad, to the point of jihad? Migration. Remember, every Muslim is supposed to recreate Muhammad's life. So that means that migration leads to jihad. Jihad leads to the Sharia. That's the cause and effect relationship here. The proper word for migration is hijra. This is so important that the Islamic calendar is based on this. instead of AD, like we use in our Western world to mark the point of beginning of counting the years, the Islamic calendar does not start with the revelation of the Quran, does not start with the birth of Muhammad. It starts with Hijra. Why? It's what led to success. So therefore, the very calendar of Islam proclaims its dominance over the kafir. This is where we started getting over on you. This is where we started killing you. We celebrate the beginning of jihad with our very calendar. And migration is a political action. America, they say, is made up of immigrants. Good enough. My family came over early from Europe. But they came for the purpose of creating a life for themselves. So migration, in our terms, is a process usually created by poverty and persecution. But in Islam, the Hijra begins the study of jihad. And here we have the same thing said. So, now then, in America, I'm called an Islamophobe. As a matter of fact, I'm proudly one of America's top 10 Islamophobes. That is a mark of success. It's hard to be top 10 at anything, but I'm a top 10 bigot. Yes. Now then, they say I'm Islamophobic. Now, most people focus on the phobia part of Islam and say I'm not crazy. I want to focus on the Islam part, not the phobic part. The Quran says to kill and hate the kafir. The Sunnah says I can be beheaded, assassinated. Muhammad had intellectuals assassinated who disagreed with him. I'm an intellectual who disagrees with him. Should I be afraid? The Sunnah says I should be afraid. Is it psychotic to be afraid of jihad, assassination, and executions? No, that's called common sense. A friend of mine who was a decorated Marine in the Vietnam War said, fear is good. Fear will save your life. So, I am afraid of Islam. I'd be stupid not to. But I'm not phobic. I'm playing heads up ball. Not just me, but any kafir who disagrees should be afraid of assassination, beheading, and executions. Why is fear of harm called bigotry? Because the people who call me this don't know anything about Islam. They are profoundly ignorant. They may own a newspaper, but they don't know anything about Islam. Jihad is not terror, and violent extremism is not jihad. A jihadist is not a terrorist. Jihad is a term that's been used for 1,400 years. The word terrorist or extremist has just been used in this century. Let's use the right word. It's been around for 1,400 years. And it's the word that the Quran and the Sirah and the Hadith use. Why should we be ashamed of using the words of Allah? Why should we be ashamed or wrong because we use the words of Muhammad? I'm just doing what it says. I read the playbook. On 9/11, my phone began to ring off the wall with people saying to me, Bill, you said something would happen. How did you know? I read the playbook. When Osama bin Laden called America to Islam, I went, whoa. A chill ran down my spine. Why? Because Muhammad called his enemies to Islam before he attacked them. So, I use the word jihad, the J word. Because that's the word of the doctrine. Now let's get this clear. There's four kinds of jihad. Muslims will proudly tell you, oh yes, the real meaning of jihad is inner struggle. That's true, but we'll see how true. There's jihad of the sword, the jihad of communication, pen and speech, and the jihad of money. Then there's the inner struggle jihad. Now then, I love precisely defined terms. The jihad of inner struggle, let's do the math. 21% of the Bukhari's hadith are about jihad. Of these jihad hadith, and there's about 7,000 of them, so that's about 1,400 hadith are about jihad. Of those 1,400 jihad hadith, 2%, actually less than 2%, I'm being generous, 2% are about jihad as inner struggle. 98% are about beheading and attacking the kafir. So, is inner struggle jihad? Yes, 2%. Is killing the kafir jihad? Yes, 98%. Now, I used to be a college professor, and if I give you 2% on a test, you fail. Jihad is not holy war. Don't ever do that. Jihad is struggle. The German word for jihad would be Kampf, I believe. It's not holy war, it's not terror. It is a systemic doctrine. And to use the word jihad is the right word. Here's the profound understanding of jihad. It is civilizational war. The genius of Muhammad was to create a new form of war. A war not based on kinetic war. The United States excels at kinetic war. If we have an enemy, all we want to do is to meet them in a plane of battle, and we will kick their butt. Bullets and bombs and blood, we do that well. But the Muslim Brotherhood does not practice that kind of jihad. They practice the jihad of money and the jihad of persuasion. We're not good at that at all. And the power of the money jihad, by the way, in Islam, the man who gives money to the jihadist gets the same reward he gets. A guaranteed seat in heaven. The jihad of money is quite powerful. Let me illustrate this. Chechnya used to be the form of Islam called Sufism. Then came the Wahhabi Muslims, the Saudis, and they started putting Saudi mosques up, teaching the real doctrine of Islam. If I were going to be a Muslim, I would become a Wahhabi Muslim, because they do it pure. Now then, I was speaking with an Afghani who dealt with the war. He was one of our spies, and they were asking about the Chechens. And he said the Chechens were the supreme best jihadist. So the Saudi money jihad transformed Chechnya from a fairly harmless form of Islam, Sufism, to a very violent form. That is the jihad of money. Civilizational war, brilliant. So therefore, for instance, the assertion that German schoolgirls should wear a hijab to school is part of civilizational war. The demand in the prison system that the inmates be served halal food is civilizational war. The fact that Muslims say to me, Bill, you can't criticize Islam, that's part of civilizational war. Jihad is eternal, jihad is global, and jihad is the success marker of Islam. So you think they're going to stop with jihad? That's stupid. Of course not. It works. Hijra is a form of jihad. It's 1,400 years old. Now I want to show you about a dynamic map of the jihad of the sword, which, by the way, is the least dangerous form of Islam. That may sound quirky. Let me explain that to you. On 9/11, 3,000 people, Americans, died. Now, in the history of a nation, losing 3,000 people is not, I don't mean this to sound cruel, is not, from a historical perfection, a bad thing. It's not a big thing. There's been other things that have killed more than 3,000 people, cigarettes. So the sword jihad is the least harmful part. But it's a 1,400, let me show you these 548 battles. What happened was, I read a huge thick book that was written on the archaeology of history. And in the back of this book, they were translated some excerpts from historic documents that had never been translated before. These contain battles of jihad that I'd never heard about. Most people only know about five big battles of jihad. So I started doing a lot of internet research, and I created a database of 548 battles that Islam fought against classical civilization. Now, how do you display 548 battles? I could give you a list, but you wouldn't look at it or read it. So I created what I call a dynamic battle map. The white dots are the current battles. The red dots include the past ones. And I think as we watch this, it'll become clear. Bang! Within 20 years, look how Islam expands after the death of Muhammad. The green is Islam. Notice that Islam is projecting power across the Mediterranean, and look how quickly, these are 20-year ticks of the clock, how quickly Iran has been crushed, Syria, Iraq, half of Turkey, Egypt, North Africa, and the invasion of Spain in the year 711, and look how much attack is being done in the south of France. Notice how the islands of the Mediterranean are being brutalized. Notice something else. This is ceaseless. Why is this attack ceaseless? It's the sunnah of Muhammad. Remember, he practiced an event of jihad about every month. This is that theory working out. Now, in Spain, the green will disappear because the Spaniards fought a 700-year, 7-century war against driving Islam out. This teaches us the lesson that jihad of the sword can be avoided, but only through extreme use of force. Now then, we're starting to press into the Balkans. Constantinople is going to fall soon. Pushing up into Austria, the gates of Vienna. Now then, the Balkans are becoming Islamic. Constantinople has fallen. And soon, on the north coast of Africa, off Tunisia, the United States will appear in the form of two battles fought against jihad, because the U.S. Marines were created to fight Muslims. That was their first combat. The United States' first navy was to fight the Islamic jihadists in the Mediterranean. Look how much it's expanded into Africa, Afghanistan, India. Notice that in Spain now, it's been driven out. And there we go. Now then, I'm also the first person, I think this dynamic battle map teaches us something, which is the jihad is relentless. Now then, as a scientist, I was also interested in the fact, well, how many people died when this was happening? And I discovered that no one had ever counted them. This tells us something. The kafir does not want to know the results of Islam. We don't want to know. We don't want to see it. We don't want to hear it. We don't want to speak about it. So I created a concept called the Tears of Jihad. These figures may or may not be right. Debate me with them. We can argue about this, but don't tell me any of these figures are zero. 60 million Christians, 10 million Buddhists, 80 million Hindus, 120 million Africans, for a total of 270 million dead. The Tears of Jihad. And people are dying today. Someone died today because of jihad. It is relentless. But remember this. Remember this. This is the least harmful form of jihad. So it's civilizational war. Now, terror is used in the Quran. I shall cast terror into the hearts of the kafir. But it is a tactical concept. Jihad, in its biggest form, is civilizational. Now then, there's a term in America, radicalization. He's been radicalized. Radicalization merely consists of saying, I'm going to practice all of Islam. Why do we call that radical? I call that fulfillment. I call that completion. He's a complete Muslim. That's what a jihadist is, someone obeying all of the Quran, all of the Hadith, and all of the Sirah. Now then, we like to use the term de-radicalize. Now, it's interesting. The people who say de-radicalize have no idea other than we would like for you to be nice. And so, but there's no one ever has come up with a good method of doing this. But it's talked about. This is the dream in America. We will de-radicalize these people. So what we're going to do, we're going to try to do is we're going to tell them, do not practice all of Islam. That verse where it says the jihadi upon being killed is assumed directly into heaven, don't practice that. The guaranteed entry into heaven, don't practice that. Do you see how this doesn't make sense? Conclusions. We can understand Islam. We can never understand Islam without Quran, Sirah, Hadith. We must use the doctrine to be objective. And any ideas about Islam that are not found in the Quran, the Sirah, and the Hadith are not Islamic terms, they're kafir terms. Use rational thought. Now, I'll warn you, if you use rational thought, you'll be called a bigot, which is odd. But you will be, but I recommend it anyway. You can't have right thoughts without the right words. I heard an interview of a man who had been very poor, and he had talent at writing. And an experienced novelist took him under his wing and taught him how to become a good novelist. He was being interviewed because he'd written a novel as a very young man, which was a big seller. And they said, what do you like best about writing? He says, oh, when you learn new words, you will have new thoughts. In the novel 1984, one of the ways that the government controlled the subjects was to control their language. You can't use that word. We will never defeat an enemy if we will not use the proper terms. Having right thoughts without right words. That's what, remember, the law enforcement officer said? He said, we can't use the right words, so we can't have the right thoughts. Don't use politically correct. By the way, I've been accused of being politically incorrect. And we should encourage debate. Science has advanced by debate. Someone advances a theory and someone says, I don't think that's right. But he doesn't call the man who advanced the theory, you hater, you bigot, you racist, you scientifophobe. Debate. And by the way, the great tragedy of American educational system is they have become institutions of ideology, not institutions of debate. In the journalism schools, they teach that they should improve the world. The old concept of a reporter was he reported both sides of the fight. But today the journalists in America are told, no, don't give a voice to the bad people and build up those who are good people. They have become ideologues. Now then, I think the most important idea I've presented to you here today is political Islam. We must discuss politics. How are we going to win a political debate, a political battle, a political election if we don't use the right words? We should encourage discussion. Our speech should encourage, what do you mean by that? And let's encourage each other with debate. Now then, let's look at what Muslims mean when they use their words. We call for peace. Peace comes after the Sharia. So the call for peace in Islam is a call to suppress and to torture and to eliminate the kafir. We want justice. Justice only comes through the Sharia. Innocent, we call for justice for innocent people. A kafir is never innocent. Because they're guilty of the primary crime, which is denying the validity of the Quran and the Sunnah of Muhammad. So I'm not innocent. And I don't want justice, Islamic justice. We categorically condemn terrorism. Terrorism under the Sharia is killing a Muslim without just cause. Apostasy and retaliation. That is, if you kill my brother, I can kill your brother. That is what terrorism is. So when a Muslim condemns terrorism, he's condemning those who are terrorists under Sharia. We stand for Sharia rights. This one is a joke. Because there's no freedom of religion, no free speech, no apostasy, no blasphemy, and no critical thought. So that's what human rights means when a Muslim uses the term. Child marriage, inbreeding, wife beating, and female genital mutilation, and polygamy. Those are Sharia human rights. Think about what that means. By the way, perhaps the greatest tragedy of Islamic human rights is inbreeding. That is a crime against future humanity. Suicide bomber. Do not call a martyr a suicide bomber because suicide is the gravest of sins. So that's the wrong term. He is a jihadist. Slander. This is something, Sharia slander is being enforced in America and Europe. Slander means to say something that is factually true but offensive to a Muslim. In America, slander means you've told a lie about me. You've smeared my reputation with a lie. In Islam, slander just means I don't like what you said. And there we have the use of some Islamic terms. We need to know what Muslims mean when they say something, and we need to know what we mean when we use the right words. So, I reminded you in the beginning, I was believe that you cannot have right thoughts without right words, you can't have a scientific approach to anything without right words, and politically, we will prevail only after people know the meaning of these words. Thank you.